excerpt was taken from a Full & Bloom interview with producer-engineer Craig Thomson. You can listen to the entire interview at fullandbloom.com. Click the link below.
May interest you to know this, I don't know, but the reason the name Pyromania came up in some respects was that Jim Marshall Amplification were sponsoring Def Leppard, and they sent a truck around with loads of cabinets and 100-watt heads. 100-watt Marshall heads. And it was all, it just gone valve state, and it was absolute crap. Everyone was different. And trying to get a good sound out, and they were just shit. And by sheer good fortune, the maintenance guy at the studio at Park Gates, he was a little Polish guy called Mike, and he used to be robbing trailers already. And he had a Marshall 100-watt head that it looked like sticks of dynamite that he taped into the back of it. He was a complete boffin, this guy. And in the back of the Sam, it had all these bloody capacitors and all sorts of things in there, which boosted it to 200 watts, and it was brilliant. It was absolutely brilliant. But the trouble was, after about 2 hours, it used to overheat. We'd have to switch it off and go and have a pint somewhere, you'd go and have a beer, and then let it cool down and then come back. And it was good old raunchy amp. It was great. Nearly caught fire a couple of times, but it was good. Yeah, it was fun.
And Pete Willis, was he still there by that point?
He was there, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, he was. I was actually there when he was sacked. I was having all kicked off. He was drinking too much. The guy was just drinking himself into oblivion. And, when it came time for his parts, he just wasn't on the case. And everybody else was given 100%, and he wasn't. And, of course, Phil Collen came down to see the band, and he knew some of the guys. And he came in, and the next thing I heard was that Phil had joined the band. I didn't actually do anything. I didn't work with Phil. I only worked with Steve, Pete, and Mutt, and Joe, of course, Joe Elliott. Yeah, Joe was great. He was good fun.
Yeah, because it said that he... go ahead. Were you going to say something?
No, not really. It's just Steve. Sadly, Steve went. He died. That was devastating, Yeah, I remember thinking, God, I've just been working with these guys. And Steve was such a nice, gentle guy, too. He was one of these guys that, off stage, he was just really shy and really kind of quiet and reserved. On stage, he was dynamite. Yeah, he was great.
Oh, yeah. He comes off he came off like that. And he just seemed like he was not rock star-ish at all. I mean, other than, like you said, on the stage, total rock star on the stage. But
he just loved it. Yeah. On stage, I thought he was a great performer on stage. Yeah. He looked great as well, Yeah.
Now, Pete did lay down some rhythm tracks.
He did.
And he's kind of a train wreck in the studio while you're doing those sessions. I mean, it's noticeable.
He was. He wasn't hacking it really. He was not getting it right. He was, he was waking up in the morning sometimes still pissed from the night before, still drunk. So, it wasn't conducive to getting things done really. And I mean, you must have heard about Mutt's. He's a stickler for perfection. You cannot be even one little bit out of sync there, or he's got you, So as a consequence, we were wasting an awful lot of time with Pete, and that was it, really.
And so you're there when he's fired?
Well, yeah, he was sent packing while I was there, yeah. Mutt was like the headmaster at school, and gave him a good ripping off, which he didn't do in front of us all. He obviously took him aside and did that, but next thing I knew, he was gone,
So that's what you remember about it, is that Mutt talked to him that day and was the one that informed him?
I think he was warned a couple of times, and then I think it just came to a head. And I think the guys in the band had worked with him as well. I think it all just, we're talking here about 40 years ago. What I was going to say to you, though, when I was telling you about these amps, the Marshall amps, I forgot to mention it, that these amps were so bad that there was building work going on at the studio. They were building up some of the old, it was an old farm, and they were building up some barns, turning them into another studio. And there was a skip outside, one of these, like a dumpster. And they were just throwing these things in the, all the amps and cabinets in the dumpster. And somebody suggested, I think it was Joe, suggested that they were going to set fire to them. I said to them, I said, you're a bunch of pyromaniacs. And that's kind of where Pyromania came from.
Wow.
Yes, that was it. So that was us just fooling about them.
Since Pete was kind of falling apart, was Steve handling most of the guitars?
Yeah, he was doing quite a lot of it. Yeah, he did. He did quite a bit. They must have kept a fair amount of Pete's stuff, really, and a lot of the rhythm guitars and things. After my little stint was over, they moved the whole operation back up to Battery Studios in Wilson in London, and that was it. It carried on from there.
You said that Joe cut his vocals there?
He was putting down, certainly putting down guide tracks, and they were kind of writing the lyrics and the vocals while it was there, you know, so he and Mutt would sit up quite late at night, you know, just working on vocals. Now, whether any of these vocals were used or not, I don't know. I don't know whether they were re-recorded or revamped at Battery Studios. I don't know what happened after I left it, really.
Were you staying in late at night with them?
Yeah, I'd be sitting around. I was there all the time, yeah, because, you know, just in case something had to be called upon. Pretty boring, actually, at that stage, because, you know, I'm sitting there while they're writing lyrics and things, but I'm there just in case they need me for something, you know? So it was.
And Mutt's credited as a songwriter, so he's in there helping craft those songs?
Well, I guess because he was writing the lyrics, he was helping Joe write the lyrics. I mean, apparently it's quite a common thing with Mutt. I found out later on that if you look at most of the stuff Mutt's ever worked on, he's got songwriting credit in most songs, and that is because he'll change a lyric or two and all the rest of it, and his contract must be something like, if I tamper with this and do something to it, and it's a hit, I'm on a slice of it, so it's quite clever.
Yeah, I just read about that recently, that Mutt really fought for himself. Even in the beginning, he was getting, he demanded 4 points on his first production, which was kind of like what an established producer would get. I interviewed somebody that produced albums that didn't get any points at all.
Yeah, God, I've done plenty of that myself, you know, when you just get ripped off at the end, especially if you're working with little indie companies and things, you know. Yeah. You get to the end of it and you suddenly find out there's no money or nobody there to pay you or anything. So it's tricky. But Mutt had great management as well. And the Zomba Group, they're quite a big, you know, big organization up in town. I think their management skills are great.
I always think of that story. I think it was on the Def Leppard Behind the Music VH1 thing. And Joe was telling a story about cutting vocals with Mutt working on one line, I think, all day or something.
Yeah, it's possible.
Whitesnake's cutting their record right next door. And Joe goes over there and David Coverdale cuts like an entire song in one take. And Joe's just like ready to crack.
No, Mutt is a stickler for perfection, you know. And I mean, in some respects, he's a hard taskmaster. But I think, you know, looking back on it now, it probably set Joe up in things, because Joe sometimes wasn't given performances like he was capable of. And what Mutt does to you is he pushes you right to your limit, which eventually you start to see what you can do instead of what you just think you can do. You know, he's good. Mutt's really clever.
And were you witness to Mutt focusing in on like a syllable, you know, like changing?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that's incredible to me, especially back then when you guys are cutting to tape.
You know, at one point, there was some of the stuff I was doing right at the very beginning. It occurred to me, because we were running over the tape so many times, it occurred to me that the tape, you know, the oxide's going to wear off the tape if that keeps happening. And I think it did at one point much later on. I think they were starting to get problems with that. So, I mean, fortunately, some of the guitar parts, I was making them maybe a little bit brighter than they should have been, but I was kind of thinking ahead and thinking maybe, well, yeah, this could, you know, if the oxide starts wearing off, this is going to start sounding pretty woolly. So, I think they did end up with oxide trouble later on. You know, the tape was beginning to shed. If you think about 12 months, 14 months maybe, of reeling tape back and forth all day long for 14 hours a day, it's a hell of a thing.